Hello, my rubber hearts. I'm so happy to welcome you back to my rubber heart for the very beginning of season 3. This season is a little bit different and in a way is very personal. When I started my career in the rubber world, I didn't have proper training. I was thrown into the lab and into production and had to figure things out as I went along. I was taught the how of the lab procedures according to standards, but not the why behind them. And that made me struggle. That is why in this season I want to go back to the basics and tackle the questions and skills that every rubber technician should know. Think of it as building a toolbox that I wish I had when I was starting out. If someone new walks into the rubber world tomorrow with no training, I want them to be able to find these videos and feel less lost than I did. Season 3 won't just be about the toolbox though. It will also have mini episodes that are quick mythbusters and hopefully some interesting interviews with people and companies working in the rubber sector. And with that, let's dive straight into episode 1 of season 3, from MDR to cure time. So what is MDR? The MDR stands for moving die rheometer. It's one of the most common instruments in a rubber lab and it gives us a cure curve, torque versus time, as rubber vulcanizes under heat. But here's the practical question that comes up all the time. Based on the MDR cure curve, how do you know how long to vulcanize your samples in the press? That's the kind of real-world decision we are going to unpack today. On the MDR curve, you will typically see a starting point called the minimum torque. That reflects the viscosity of the uncured rubber. Then, as cross-linking kicks in, the torque rises, and eventually you reach what we call T90. That's the time to reach 90% of the total torque increase, essentially 90% of the cure. Some labs also talk about T95, depending on how conservative they want to be. These times are calculated automatically by the rheometer software, but here's the catch. The cure time in the press is never exactly the same as the T90 in the rheometer. Why not? Because the rheometer chamber has a very thin sample and highly controlled heating. The press, on the other hand, has thick mold cavities, variable heating, and real-world conditions. So you need a correction factor. A good rule of thumb is to take the T90 from the MDR and add about 20 to 30% to account for heat transfer into the bulk of the part. So if your MDR says T90 is 8 minutes, you would probably start with 10 minutes in the press. But this correction isn't universal. It depends on the thickness of the part, the press efficiency, and even the specific rubber formulation. And speaking of thickness, let's get really clear on this point. When we talk about correcting for cure time, we are usually curing samples in the lab press for testing. The thickness of the sample has a direct impact on how long it takes for heat to penetrate through and cure the entire piece. A practical way to think about it is that for each additional millimeter of thickness, you add some extra time to the cure. A common rule of thumb is to add about 30 seconds to 1 minute of cure time for each extra millimeter of thickness. For example, tensile test sheets are usually around 2 millimeters thick, so they cure relatively quickly. But samples for the Matia testing are about 6 millimeters thick, which means you might need to add an extra 2 to 4 minutes compared to the base T90 values to make sure the heat reaches the core. If you only use the base T90 without considering thickness, you risk having undercured centers in your thicker samples. So when you are setting press times in the lab, always consider both the MDR curve and the actual thickness of the test piece you are molding. Another important point is scorch time, or TS2, which is the time to reach a small increase in torque, often 2 units. This tells you how much safe processing window you have before cure start. Scorch time is not your cure time, but it's equally important because it defines whether you can safely handle and mold your compound without premature curing. In the end, the MDR gives you a reference curve with the key times like T90 and T95. You use those to estimate your press cure time, but you always need to validate with real molded samples. Think of MDR data as the map and your press as the territory. The map helps you navigate, but you still need to look up and see where you are going. And that is our first step in season 3, taking lab data and learning how to apply it in practice. This is exactly the kind of skill that transforms a beginner into a confident rubber technician. Next time, we'll keep building the toolbox. But for now, I would love to hear from you. How do you decide your press cure time in your lab or factory? Drop a comment below and let's start season 3 with a real conversation.